Good morning, or afternoon, or evening, or whenever it is that you're viewing this. This is our discipleship class, meeting again here, a little bit different here today. Different for me because I am teaching to two people, Mark and my wife here. So we don't know how this is going to go here as far as audience participation, interaction, but hopefully we'll be able to at least get the basics here for topic eight. So we are on topic eight here. We just finished chapter two, and in chapter two, we learned about a disciple, what a disciple does. A disciple learns, he grows, and he serves. And as we get into chapter three today, and topic eight, we are going to look at what being a disciple means. Being a disciple means that you are a student. And as a student, you have basically one responsibility, as any student would have. And who might know what that might be? Kathy, what's the only responsibility a student has?
Listen to the teacher.
To listen.
And learn.
And to learn, exactly. You don't have a book either, do you? Here. Mark, would you get her one? Yeah, that's exactly. Being a disciple means that a student learns. You learn. And as we learned in chapter two, you've got a responsibility as a disciple to learn, you've got a responsibility to grow, and you have a responsibility to serve. And so we're going to focus today on just what that responsibility of learning entails. And obviously you have to have something to learn, and we're going to look today at topic eight, which is the Bible, which is the primary source of where all our learning will take place from. So, we need to learn about what? Certain things, as our lesson says. We need to learn about the Bible. We need to learn about God and the Holy Trinity, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And then we also need to learn about the church. So, with that idea in mind, let's look down here. What does a devoted follower of Jesus need to understand and believe about the Bible? This is the primary source of our learning, and so with that in mind, it behooves us to know all we can or learn all that we can about this sacred work of the Lord's. The Bible is our primary source of information about God. This is our textbook, if you will, as a disciple. This is your textbook. And in that textbook, there's two ways that we learn. The first is, as it says here, general revelation. General revelation. Who can tell us what that is? Mark, what is general revelation?
That is what God has created that we can see, and the world around us and everything like that.
Exactly. And it gives us a scripture here in Romans, the first chapter of Romans 18 to 21. Let me read that, because this is good doctrine here. The wrath of God is being revealed from heaven against all the godlessness and wickedness of men who suppress the truth by their wickedness, since what may be known about God is plain to them because God has made it plain to them. For since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities, his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly seen, being understood from what has been made, so that men are without excuse. For although they knew God, they neither glorified him as God nor gave him thanks, but their thinking became futile and their foolish hearts were darkened. Just by looking at nature, just by looking at the sun coming up in the morning and the moon at night, and looking at the stars and the heavens and the beautiful creation, man is without excuse to deny the existence of God. So that's what's called a general revelation. Your conscience tells you that there's a God. They say that if you go to a place like Grand Canyon, and you get out at the summit of Grand Canyon, look around and behold the breathtaking beauty of just what you see, how can anybody deny that there's a God? And I think we get pretty much inspired by the awe that we see in nature and just say, wow, this has to be done by a divine force, and that force, of course, is God. The second way we know and understandably the Bible is by what's called a special revelation. And the special revelation most commonly refers to the Bible, God's written word. In the Bible, we see details about God's person and plan and an explicit record of the teachings and actions. And this is done as recorded by the prophets. The prophets and those who wrote scripture. So we have the special revelation is done by men who were inspired by the Holy Spirit to actually write the actions that you see and hear and all the stuff that takes place in the Bible. So those we come by the knowledge then and learn in the Bible from general revelation and by what's called special revelation. Now, you look at the Bible here, the little description down here, this little visual, which I think they create, which is very neat, orderly description of the books of the Bibles. We know that the books of the Bible, they're all listed here for you. The first five, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, called the Law, and we also go by the name the Torah, and it's also the Pentateuch. How you pronounce that, Mark?
Pentateuch.
Moses had written, and those were, I think, written by Moses.
Yes.
Okay. So those are the first five books, and then the categorized. The second part is the history, which we have Joshua through Esther. Then we got poetry, Job through the Song of Solomon. And then we have the rest of the books here, the major prophets. Then we have the minor prophets. What's the difference between a major prophet and a minor prophet? Why do they call some major and some minor?
The only difference is the length of the writing.
Yeah.
The longer is a major, the shorter is minor. Yeah. But most certainly it's not in the message itself.
Exactly. Yeah. And you just look at the size of the books here. The ones on the left are a little bit bigger. They're called the major prophets. But as Mark said, it's not because their message is any less significant. It just has to do with the size of the books. And then, of course, then we get into the New Testament then. The Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, we all know them. And then, of course, then the history, which starts at the history. Acts, I've heard two different interpretations of the Act. One is it's the Acts of the Apostles. Inspired by the Holy Spirit, so it's the Acts of the Apostles or the Acts of the Holy Spirit, written in the Book of Acts. You've got the Epistles, and then of course the Epistles to Friends, the General Epistles, and then ending up with the Book of Revelations. So those are the books that make up this textbook that we're reading as disciples. The bread and butter, if you will, of our Christian discipleship comes from this book. What's so special about it? If you look at the next page, there's six characteristics that we're going to mention here this morning. Six characteristics that make the Bible the Bible. Its influence, its claims to be of divine origin, its reliability, and then we're going to have two more in terms of what the additional characteristics would be. It's authoritative, and it's transformational. And we'll look at those as we go in through each one of those. First of all, before we look at that, let's look at this little chart here from God to Us. These are just five religious terms that we talk about as pastors and as teachers, and I'm sure as in your study you've come across the idea of what a revelation means. If something is revealed to you, what does that mean, Kathy? Exactly. It's unveiled to you. Mark is doing a study now on the book of Revelation. It's unveiling what John saw. Was it
John?
John. So the unveiling that you're taking off the cloak, you're opening up the package and you're seeing what has been revealed to you, shown to you. Inspiration kind of guides us. We get inspired to do something. The Spirit, the Holy Spirit, is guiding all of our efforts. Certainly, the book of the Bible was inspired by God, as the prophets wrote and as the authors wrote them. They were inspired. The inerrancy also talks about the lack of error. There's no error in it. Canonicity, a big word, basically. Canonicity, Mark, what's an easy way to remember that?
The writings that were accepted by the church, which came together to be our one book, the Bible.
Yeah, yeah. There's other books of the Bible, the Apocrypha, you've heard about those. Those are books that, they're pretty good stories, but they haven't been accepted by the council, the big group that had all the authority rejected some of the books of the Bible. And that was in, they were still maybe written, but not did not have the authorization from the sacred seal of this group to give them their stamp of approval. And then, of course, in scriptures, we have illumination, the ongoing work of the Holy Spirit to enable God's people to comprehend and apply the written word of God, to illuminate the aha. What you read something and all of a sudden it hits you. So illumination simply means a lot like revelation, the light goes on, you get it. So we're going to look now at the study of the Bible, and the first characteristic, the Bible is special because of its influence. It's far and away the most published book in history, and I'm sure most of you have heard that's a fact, that it has been published more than any other book in the world. Just a little pop quiz for you here. Does anybody know the second and third most published books in the world? No.
No.
The second one are the works of Shakespeare. And the third one, you could guess from now until the rapture, and I don't know anybody would get it. It's a mystery writer. Agatha Christie.
Really?
Her works are the third most published.
Huh.
Just a little tidbit there, a little information you might want to share. Maybe
like Michael Barry Finn.
Let's see, that was written by
Mark Twain.
I don't know where he is on the list, but I just came across that. I couldn't tell you where I found that information, but I it was significant, and I've said that now in study school class in here, so I think I can believe its authenticity. So it is its influence. The second characteristic is special due to its claims to be of divine origin. What does that mean, to be of divine origin? If something is divinely originated, what does that mean? Mark?
God is the originator of the writings.
Yeah.
He has inspired those authors to write what he says or mm-hmm. what he wants.
Yeah. You can't get any higher than God inspiring someone to write something. It always amazes me. I go to bookstores or libraries, and you see all these books that were written by countless authors, and people just flock to those. When they hear about Dr. Oz or somebody else, they flock. I want to see what this guy says. Shouldn't we be as ready to look at a book that was inspired by the creator of the world? So I often wonder, you know, and obviously the book continues to be the number one seller because people are doing that, and praise the Lord for that. But it is the authoritative word of the person that created the entire universe. And I think as such, then, it's pretty special. Let's allow the Bible to speak for itself. All scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. What's your initial observations about this verse? When you read that, what strikes you? Mark, could you tell us?
Well, the idea that the breath of God, I mean, the word created, and the idea that God, it came from his mouth, so to speak, and we can use this in our practical living, by teaching, by living, correcting us, to change us, rebuke us, to teach us how to be, live the right way in righteousness.
Absolutely. Yeah, and it's all here. It's all here in Scripture. The Word of God, the Word of the Almighty Creator, we can use it to correct, to help, to teach. That should be something that we should be thirsting for on a daily basis. And it says, so that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. You have all you need to know for deeds, to accomplish the deeds of a Christian, to help or as a servant. So you've got the basic ingredients here, and now it just means you have to read it and to apply it, and the product should bear fruit.
You know, I'm looking up something here because the King James translates it, all scripture is given by inspiration of God, profitable for doctrine and that. But it originates with God.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the main point of all of that.
Mm-hmm. All right, scripture, the Greek word is graphe, which means that which is written. In other words, scripture is the writings of the Old Testament and the New Testament. It's God-breathed, as Mark has just kind of implied here. It expresses the idea of exaltation by God. God didn't breathe into existing human writings. He inspired the original, which I think is pretty interesting. He didn't fine-tune words that were already there. There were no other words prior to that. So he didn't just tweak this one or tweak that. He actually was the original. He made it from the very beginning. They were his words and his words alone. And for that, they are very special. He told the Bible writers the exact words to say. And when he wasn't using the exact words, he gave them, let them use their own personal slant on things. Which accounts for some of the little bit of differences in the writings that you have. Another passage that boldly maintains divine authorship of Scripture is 2 Peter. For we're not making up clever stories when we told you about the powerful coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. We're not making these up. These are not coming from us. These are divine words that were given to us from the author himself, Jesus, or our Lord God Almighty. We ourselves heard that voice from heaven when we were with him on the holy mountain. First hand account. They actually were there when God gave them those words. What do Peter's eyewitnesses' words tell us about Scripture and the way it came to be? It's authentic. It's the real deal. It's the real deal. All right, it talks a little bit more about some of the verses and the transfiguration and so forth, and you can kind of look at that on your own here. I want to get right here, just if you can, maybe question three over here. It talks about a time when you felt like you'd been pierced by the truth and beauty of God's word. Kind of a personal insight, perhaps, on something that you read and maybe how it impacted you in your life. Mark, can you kind of give us a little bit of that one, a number three there on page?
Yeah,
72?
I was in college and of course was influenced by the culture of the time, and I was constantly saying, what is reality? What is real to you is not real to me, or what is truth to you is not necessarily truth to me. Truth is relative.
Mm-hmm.
And then in my Bible studies, I came across the verse that said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And I realized that the way of Jesus, the morality of Jesus that he presented, was the real and only truth that there could be.
Mm-hmm.
And the Word of God really became authentic in my life. So.
Interesting. Good. Good. Thank you for sharing that. The third characteristic, we're over here on page 72. The Bible is special because of its reliability, its trustworthiness. And there are, I think we're going to look at maybe five evidences of just how trustworthy the Bible can be. Evidence one, there are more than 5,000 portions or fragments that exist. On our trip to Israel several years ago, Kathy and I saw some of these fragments, and all the pieces were put together, the actual original writings of the Bible. And with all those copies, we have the knowledge that the Jewish scribes who copied the scriptures were obsessed with accuracy. I think maybe, Mark, you can tell us a little about every jot and jittle and all those things. They were pretty, they wanted their every one of those things to be accurate before they put that into actual transcription.
The scribes would actually count how many letters there were and where the midpoint was in the copy that they were doing.
Okay.
Then when they copied that manuscript, they would check to see if they had the right number of letters on that. So they were very, they could have their hand taken off if they were misrepresenting any of the sacred scriptures.
Right. Yeah.
So.
And this was in the day before whiteout too, so they had to be very particular. If they made a mistake, they would have to go back over and redo the whole thing. So they were tremendously accurate in that. Very precise wording of all the documents. This is kind of interesting here. This Princeton's Bruce Metzger, perhaps the preeminent New Testament scholar of the 20th century, concluded that after 2,000 years of being copied, only 40 of the 20,000 lines of the New Testament are debatable. Only 40. And more importantly, none of those 40 lines affects the basic understanding or the basic tenets of the Old Testament. So there might be a little bit different wording, but as far as the actual message goes, it does not affect the actual message. Evidence two, the unity of the scriptures. They're composed by 40-some authors in three languages, Hebrew, Aramaic, and Greek. And Aramaic was nothing more than the ancient language that related to the Semites of the Middle East, of which they were Jews, Arabs, and the Aramaics. Over a period of 1,500 years, yet it is really one book with a flowing story and consistent message. So even though 40 different authors had input into it, it really is just kind of a story that flows from the beginning to the potential end of the world, in essence. And it makes a very nice story. Throughout its pages, the Bible champions belief in one God, in times and regions where polytheism, belief in many gods, was the norm. So throughout the Bible, it constantly stresses one God, the Almighty Creator, the God of Abraham, Jacob, and Isaac. The Old Testament foreshadows the New Testament. The New completes the story of the Old. I don't know if you've ever heard the idea sometimes that the Old Testament conceals the Word of God and the New Testament reveals. So the Old Testament conceals what is going to happen, and then the New Testament reveals that with the Messiah and the Lord, Lord Jesus coming. The Bible calls people to live by faith in God's grace, whereas every other religion depicts humans working to earn God's favor. I think that's the one big thing, and we've discussed this, I'm sure, in our other discipleship classes. The one thing that separates Christianity from all the other religions is the grace, the unmerited favor that God gives his people. All the other religions, they're trying to work and do good deeds and trying to appease this God and appease this God to win favor with their God. And our Lord God has been so merciful that while we were sinners, he sent his son to die for us. So the God's grace certainly is a distinguishing characteristic in the Christian faith. The preservation of the scriptures, no other book has survived such hatred and opposition. I think that's, if you know any history at all in the history of the Jewish, their persecution with the Bible and all the kinds of things that Christians have continued to endure, the Bible is still around. Number four is worthy of some discussion here at this point, the fulfilled prophecies. What's a prophecy? What is a prophecy? Mark.
Prophecy is something which will come about in the future. Many of the prophets foretold the birth of Jesus long before he ever came, mm-hmm. or certain events.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So the prophecies, I think, from what I've read, I don't exactly know the exact number. We're told here it contains almost 2,000 prophecies in the book. Our textbook contains 2,000 prophecies. Some are in the Old Testament, some are in the New, giving us that total. Many of these have been fulfilled. Some are yet to be fulfilled. But it's interesting here, I have just a small portion, 365 messianic prophecies from Genesis all the way to Malachi. And these are things, a virgin, Christ will be born to a virgin. Isaiah talks about, in fact, Isaiah has a lot of them as we look to Christmas here, and Isaiah is quoted most oftenly in the Christmas season, a lot of these prophecies. And it's interesting that they happened exactly as they were predicted, and mathematicians have demonstrated the logical impossibility of that many lucky guesses. I had a handout, and I don't know what I did with it, but it said something to this effect, that they've calculated the odds of Christ fulfilling just 10 of the 1,000 prophecies that he fulfilled. And they said the odds of him fulfilling even 10 of those thousands of prophecies would be akin to taking a bunch of silver dollars and taking one silver dollar and painting one side white, painting the other black, and taking all the silver dollar, enough silver dollars to go through every state in the Union, pile those silver dollars 3 feet high, and take that one and toss it in the air before you put it in the states, mixed it all up, and having somebody go in blindfold and pick out that black and white silver dollar out of all those silver dollars that are 3 feet high, covering every state in the Union. So you pick one of those out, and that's the chances of Jesus fulfilling only 10 of those 2,000 prophecies. So those are pretty narrow odds. And the fact that he fulfilled all of them should be... any questions? Any questions on this at all?
Yeah.
It's just a little interesting sidelight about the odds of that happening. And evidence 5, the archaeological record. Archaeologists continue to uncover evidence of the Bible's accuracy. I think this year alone, I read a couple stories in the newspaper. I think they're continuing to do archaeological diggings in Israel at the temple grounds and the ruins, and they're always finding something that they can say, hey, this is proof again that the Bible is real. Additional characteristics, there are two other ones here. Authoritative. We don't get to explain away teaching that offend us. Boy, if there is something that is certainly under attack today is the authority of the Bible. We have people that are claiming to be Christians that are picking up the Bible and they're giving credence and sanction to homosexual marriage and all different types of things that suit their agenda. I think real quickly of this Pete Buttigieg he's got a homosexual relationship, and he claims to be a born-again Christian, and he has quoted the Bible, parts of the Bible, to justify the homosexuality. And I think we're finding that's very dangerous in our world today, that people are doing that, taking the Bible and twisting it to meet their own means. And it's not good, and it's something that the Lord certainly does not take lightly to. The bottom line isn't his or her feelings. What the majority thinks is right according to the latest time poll. What the laws the government has passed, the rulings, the Supreme Court, interesting, the Supreme Court can make a decision on a 2,000-year-old practice of marriage being one man and one woman, and yet they don't want to take the issue of election fraud that has occurred recently. It's kind of interesting about our Supreme Court. So the issue obviously is, what does the Word of God say? Everything that's done everywhere should be measured by one yardstick, and that is, what does our textbook say? And that textbook, of course, is the Word of God. Let us look at this second question here on page 75. So Jesus was saying to those Jews who believed in him, if you continue in my word, then you are truly disciples of mine. You will know the truth, and the truth will make you free. To truly be a disciple of Christ, to be a disciple of his, what do you have to do? You are truly disciples of mine. If what? Kathy? Page 75, second one, second question. If you continue in my word, in the word. Obedience. It just comes down to obedience. You say you're a follower of Jesus. Let me see what you do. Let me see your actions. Do you obey him? It's really as simple as that. You will know the truth, and the truth will make you free. And last but not least, we're talking about the Bible being transformational. This is the an additional characteristic. What's it mean to transform? What is a transformational issue?
Change.
Change. Yeah, a change. The Bible will change you.
From the inside out.
From the inside out. From the inside out. And I think, you know, Eddie, it's interesting just how many resources that the teachers have at our disposal that show lives being changed and transformed. It's usually some kind of a hard luck story where a guy was down on his luck and alcoholic and literally in the gutter, and then somehow the Word of God came to that person through a revelation or an experience, and they sucked it up and they started to read more and delve more. And to this day, they'll tell you that it was a divine miracle that saved them and actually changed their lives from what they were down in the gutters to now going on the circuit and preaching and teaching and you know, selling books and doing all this. And obviously that's not the intent of it, to make you rich and famous, but certainly has changed their lives. And now those folks are changing the lives of others because other people are reading about their success story and getting into the Word because of a transformational a change that actually takes place within you. The scripture says, and a mountain of evidence and experience shows that the Bible is alive. Its truth can pierce the hardest heart and heal the most broken soul. No other book can renew our minds and bear supernatural fruit. So you see all these self-help books that are in the bookstores today, the one you probably want to grab if you haven't done so already is the Bible, because there's probably no greater self-help book in the world than the Bible, because it was written by our Creator himself. All right, I've appreciated your indulgence here, class, and your responses. Next time you get together, we'll be looking at lesson number 9, and think rightly about the Creator. So until that time, I want to take this time now to wish you and yours a very Merry Christmas, and continue to be light in this very dark world that we have, and it could possibly grow much darker. So Merry Christmas to all of you, and to all a good night.